start off with Fatima Adam from Zenix Foundation. We will then carry on to Kelly Kuhn from Red Ink and Kim Porteous from the Magic Classroom Collaboration. So, please, Fatima.
Hey, thank you. I just have one important slide to present on collaboration, but I also thought that I need to just tell you who I am, you know, where I come from, which is Zenix Foundation, for those of you who don't know. Okay, so Zenix is a grant maker. We were established in 1994, and since then we've been involved in mathematics or supporting mathematics education at a number of levels in the system. Over time, our strategies evolved through reflection, feedback, research, evaluations, etc. Right? So, just in a nutshell, initially, so just to talk a little bit about what influenced our current strategy. Initially, we funded a number of small projects in maths education, and it went across the schooling system. And then we realized that it wasn't going anywhere. We weren't achieving the impacts that we envisaged. We then went to, we undertook a process of looking through evidence from different spaces. And from that, we came up with a few things around what, to guide our strategy. And those were, the big ones were that there were very few interventions in foundation phase. So it gave us an impetus to work there as opposed to across the sector. There were too many small projects and they were not researched or evaluated appropriately. There were no large-scale interventions with kind of rigorous counterfactual studies, not enough understanding of the pedagogical mechanisms driving poor outcomes. And these sort of main issues pointed us in a direction which sort of led us to explore and support mathematics education across like four levers, if you like. So the four levers we chose were backlogs, professional development of teachers, curriculum reform, and research. And so in those four areas, we have a number of projects at different levels. So it's pilots or scales or kind of working towards systemic efforts, but they focus on the areas listed below them. So it's evident for us that backlogs is a big issue. It was a big issue, as was, I think as Bonita mentioned, and even Shahida, around, before COVID. So it's exacerbated by COVID, and working on those, we then sort of fiddling with a few areas that we believe can sort of help us think through and work through the idea, mitigate learning backlogs in mathematics education. Then, of course, professional development, both in in-service and pre-service. We're experimenting with a range of models because we don't believe that there's a blueprint or a magic bullet, and we think that a number of different ideas may help us get there. We think that curriculum reform is an opportunity, and again mentioned by Shahida Jaffa, around opportunities to review CAPS, and we want to be involved in that in some way. And then all kinds of research. And at the moment, we have an early grade maths program, and I think Nikki presented some of that, but it's led by Stephen Taylor in the department. And then there's some research on language and mathematics, and also ICTs and maths. So in a nutshell, that's the kind of work we do. Then sort of moving closer to the topic of the panel is collaboration, right, and partnership. So we, of course, we committed to collaboration, and everybody would say that. And we believe that there are different levels of collaboration depending on the nature of projects and programs that we work in. So it ranges from co-design and co-funding projects with others to creating platforms for reflection and learning across stakeholders using evidence, etc. And we buy into the idea that collaboration is necessary, particularly in under-resourced contexts, because it allows for consolidation of learning across the sector, and it pools resources and expertise around a common goal, and also has the potential to collectively influence policy, because on our own, I think we will go nowhere slowly. But having said all of those great things about collaboration, it is very difficult to implement. And I think if I were to raise a few issues, the one is that organizations have different identities and mandates, and they have different dispositions and power, right? And then it's not easy to arrive at a consensus about what works. So based on all of that, we strongly believe in collaboration. We think it must happen. Otherwise, we reinvent the wheel. We don't get anywhere. We don't influence policy. But in order to address those, we need to square up to the fact that we have different mandates, identities, and powers, and to the fact that in a math education community, we hardly see sufficient consensus around what works. And from a donor perspective, we struggle with that. So in a conclusion, just to say going forward, the first one is, how do we ensure that our work is informed by evidence? Because I think that's one way in which we can go forward, and we can go forward carefully, and you know, we can go forward and build. But everybody says that they're influenced by evidence, and they were research-based, etc., etc. It's just, what does evidence mean? What does rigorous evidence mean? And who decides? Those are the things that we struggle with, right? Can we then, in terms of solutions, can we have many different ones underpinned by a set of commonly agreed principles? And how do we get together to build those principles? And who polices that? Right? Who makes decisions about that? So all about sort of the difficulties around how we get ourselves together in a room and who we are, what our dispositions and powers are. And then finally, how do we balance protecting our spaces and interests, our mandates, but while working towards the common goals? So it's really about saying, really, we're very keen on collaboration, but we really think we need to think practically about how these things work, right? That's it. I think I'm good on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fatima. And with that, I'm going to then allow Kelly Kuhn to come and join us on behalf of Red Ink.
Thank you. My mic is on. Yes, it is now. Thank you. I'm just going to put up one slide, and I was saying to Jamia, she set a precedent, and she sat, so I'm going to do the same if nobody minds. Hi, I'm Kelly Kina from, I'm actually an independent consultant. I was at the Schools Development Unit at UCT for about 21 years, and previously in an organization at UCT called MEP. And, I mean, I say that because the kind of collaboration that has enabled me to talk about Grade R in particular has grown over an incredibly extensive period. And I left UCT in March, and I'm currently independent. I'm representing Red Ink, which is an NGO, and the program manager of the Bala Wande Matik Grade R is currently training and couldn't be here. So I think part of the challenge with the kind of collaboration that I've been involved in, and I'm going to personalize it quite a lot and then talk generally about the work and the development around Grade R. I think over the last few years, probably now about 20 years, the debate and the discussions around theory and practice and content and context, and they've been very, they've been pendulums, they've been different perspectives, and I've always been a foundation phase. I did my own research in early maths, and I found it quite difficult in the sort of broader context to find a location that enabled me to think about early maths and think about maths content. I wasn't a mathematician. I was a foundation phase, one of those generalists. And so I learnt with colleagues, particularly in the School of Ed, but also in other ATIs and other organizations, and with teachers in the classroom, and through the kinds of materials that we were developing for training, from qualifications to workshops to, you know, trying it all on, but trying it on with teachers. So the kinds of partnerships and the kinds of conversations really had me mulling things. And then in 2016, a funder asked if I would be interested in writing a grade R maths program. And I was like terrified. I mean, you know, I've been told, and I had been told until it was trendy to think otherwise, that there was no maths in grade R. I was like, how do I do that? You know, I've always worked from grade one up. Anyway, it was a huge challenge. And the WCED became a partner in an initiative that it was their initiative to roll out to the whole province, a grade R program, train all their grade R teachers. And this was in 2016, and at the time there was so much advocacy around grade R, which had fallen into the space between preschool and grade one curriculum. And I think everybody knows most of the programs have been written from grade one to grade three. And so we had this discussion around, well, what, you know, what is the content that one wants to do for grade R in preparation for grade one? And a lot of that situation has changed. There are more grade R classes. Grade R teachers are more qualified. So at that stage, it really was around finding spaces to really talk about the content that would be appropriate in preparing children for mathematical thinking as well as for grade one. So the CAPS was our framework. We were constrained by CAPS and really wanted to delve into the what we all call big ideas. And so the collaboration was really, I mean, I worked very closely with Kim and Ingrid and Nikki in particular in thinking about these, and Ingrid mastered. And there were a number of reference groups and people really starting to talk about this. And we were trying to like tease out the strands, the conceptual strands that would be important to include in a program. Anyone who thinks I'm talking to friends, I'm not, my notes are here. And the work that PrimTed was doing and various other spaces where these conversations were happening were really important to try to articulate in an accessible way for teachers a program that they could implement. And amidst the theory and the content was the method, the pedagogy, whole class, small groups, language issues, reversioning. I mean, there were so many things to consider. And in terms of the teachers, many of the grade R teachers, that situation is still relevant, have a level 5 qualification, not qualified with a B.Ed, not having done maths, and being asked to prepare children for a curriculum, which is rooted in some, you know, mathematical ideas. So the other issues were around taking a program like this to scale. And it was the Western Cape, but obviously we were thinking of a national profile. And as Nikki said earlier on about one size doesn't fit all. So how do you present for teachers a program that supports them and also gives them access to what it is that you're wanting the children to learn? So deciding on a structure, and again, there's also that discussion between lesson plans or no lesson plans, workbooks, no workbooks, worksheets. I mean, all of that had, you know, came into discussion. And then, of course, the reality of the classroom context. And I think, so the work at UCT was the development of a grade R program in the Western Cape, was called RMATS, and it's currently rolling out in Gauteng. And the work with Bala Wande was working with the same content, but trying to present it in a different way. And again, I'm not going to get into the detail of the whole class, small group. I mean, it's another discussion. But the language, I mean, the Great Art Program was very strongly rooted in language development, development of vocabulary, for being able to, encouraging children to share their ideas, to talk, encouraging or helping teachers to talk to children and to ask questions. So these sound like really mundane things, but they things that teachers find very difficult. When you've got 35 and 6-year-olds and they're all running around, it's very difficult to teach the children, let alone kind of assess. So we put the program together with an overview of how the teacher manages this teaching in the classroom. And what the, in terms of the content, when Bonnie presented those items that the grade ones were failing on, you know, two rabbits sharing four carrots and not knowing what a five was, it's like, I don't know what to say. I don't know how to say it, because that's grade R work. I mean, if a 6-7-year-old is not able to count to five or share, or it's quite distressing. But just very quickly, the key, and someone must wave at me because, you know, I think I'm going to be 5 minutes, but I could talk for 2 days. I think in terms of the strands, the conceptual strands, and a lot of the discussions we had a number of years ago, and with Ingrid in some of our working groups, and Nikki, how do you map the kinds of trajectories? What is it from grade R, where maybe it's not calculations, but what are the kind of preparatory things? So if we're thinking cardinality and we're thinking ordinality, we want the children to understand certain concepts and have skills. And so the issue of representations and what I'd call multiple representations, and you can see from the photographs above, and I wanted you to see the children, I wanted you to see the interaction, because what the programs do is that, Anna was joking about doing one for 4 weeks and two for, 10 weeks. And what we tried to do was to do various aspects of number in parallel. So you didn't just count. And the grade one teachers are so proud of the fact that their children can count to 50. And that's oral counting. But as we know, they can't count to five. So the multiple representations, modeling for children with concrete objects, letting children count, iconic representations, symbolic representations, and really getting teachers to understand that for children to understand a concept which is totally abstract in our heads, they need to associate, first of all, counting the objects, then with the said word, then with the symbol, then with the written word. It's an incredibly complex process for a young child. 5 minutes. Okay. So those conceptual strands, I mean, the multiple representations, so it's like washing lines, number lines, I mean, jumping tracks. That's all of it, all behind me. But I think one of the main things that we tried to make explicit in the program was the transition from counting to thinking about numbers as units. So, I mean, somebody said to me in a workshop the other day, the kids are fantastic, they can count on, the sort of counting on, counting all seems to have been the rhetoric of the last few years. And what I was saying is fantastic, but they're still counting. So how do we get the children to say 2 plus 2 and 3 is 5? And I think that's one of the strongest components of the content, is around the kinds of games, the kind of activities that are embedded in the program around this transition from counting to unitizing. Thank you.
So with that then, thank you for firstly
us coming from the funding perspective, now seeing what collaboration can do in terms of bringing something new into life. And then Kim, I'd like you to come up to tell us more from the classroom, Magic Classroom Collective perspective.
Thank you, Lisa. Just first, I wanted to thank this environment. This to me is a lot about what collaboration is about. And I think a lot of us are really busy and we resist these kind of invites when they come in because it feels like a lot of time. But I think to just be able to listen to each other as a sector and think more carefully about how we're defining the problem and how we're approaching the problem is really valuable. So thank you. When I think about collaboration, the last introductory point I wanted to make is I think a lot about how are we serving our colleagues in the DBE. I think the pressures on the DBE are very different from those of us in research and development. And I know there's several people in the DBE, Stephen, Carol, Benita, some others. And I think a lot about whether or not those of us who are in research development that's really committed to the classroom, have we figured out ways of sharing and cycles and rituals of sharing that actually can be absorbed, or do we sound like a lot of noise? I'm conscious of that. I'm not going to answer that because that's the question I have for myself, but it's one of the things I think a lot about. And maybe just one more introductory comment is I just wanted to take on one thing that was said earlier and something that I'm worried about. I know Arno well, and I don't have a problem with him, but I have a problem with something he said today. And I wish you were there because I'll tell him that as well. I really think we need to be careful about how we speak about teachers. And I understand the frustration with teachers, and I understand how undermined our teaching project has been, and I'm going to talk to that. But I think we need to be really careful about how we talk about going around teachers. And I think one of the reasons, one, because myself, I'm in love with teachers, but that's kind of beside the point. But I think there's a wave over us at this historic moment. And I think that wave is a bunch of tech people, probably based in Silicon Valley, who are going to solve African education through tablets and facilitators. And the trained public teacher, the quality African teacher who takes care of our children and engages them in critical thinking is going to get lost. I think that is a hugely possible future, and I think the only way we prevent that future is to get behind the notion of the quality African public teacher. So I just wanted to say that. So that kind of, when I was thinking about collaboration, I think a lot about this line. I'm sure others of you think about it as well, but it's something that keeps me up at night. And you can see the technical work down here. Most of it is drawn from Stephen's work from 2011, Taylor and Wu, as well as Servas's work. And I think Stephen is always laughing at me, like, why do you always use this one study? Like, why? It's, by the way, it's repeated in many studies. But if anybody hasn't read this particular version of it, it's really powerful for me. And not much has changed yet. And it really, what it suggests down here, I've simplified above, because sometimes simplifying things helps us think. And it essentially the paper says that across the world, right, there is a relationship between the socioeconomic context of a child's home and her school and her systematic chance at educational performance. So there is no place in the world that has overcome that curve. No? So in most countries, if you're less unequal, it will be more gradual, and if you're more unequal, it will be more sloped. No? But I don't think many of us really get, and it took me this paper to truly get it, that in South Africa, the only place where that relationship holds is in Model C schools. No? That's that top quintile of schools. So we do have a relationship between if my child coming from a more resourced environment versus another child coming from a less resourced environment, my child has systematically more chance at succeeding. The relationship doesn't yet hold very well for the first 60 to 70% of our children. Nah? So that whole promise, that 1994 promise that hopefully we haven't let go of, that democracy holds the promise of the public education that starts equalizing our country, we haven't yet gotten to that, i.e. between, basically the first 70% of education is still almost totalizing. So even as a grandmother reads to her child or does all the things we can do in our communities and homes, if she's in one of these, a quintile 1, 2, 3, even 4 is a little bit more complex, her systematic chances of keeping up, of educational performance at curricular levels are very small. Huh? So that's devastating. It's a reality, and it's devastating. And I wonder whether or not all of us get together and think a lot about what does collaboration mean in the context of this kind of bimodal system? And my sense is for some time now, collaboration has meant mainly just almost like our instincts, not because we're thinking about it. That it means that in this Model C system, in quintile, 5, no? That's where all the knowledge is, no? And the expertise is, no? And if only we could share that knowledge with the rest of the system, then our teachers will come up. Does it make sense? Thank you, Nosisi. But that is, I do think that that's been our implicit, both in funders and in higher education, this knowledge, and hoy it into that knowledge, and then we're frustrated that teachers don't listen to us. They have bad attitudes. Nah? If only a teacher would listen. Nah? I've heard, by the way, many, many, many people say, if only, no, it's good, but if only teachers would listen. Huh? There's another hypothesis here, now, which for me is really challenging and really powerful, which is to say that these schools are working, at least largely because the knowledge system that we're producing as this collective, this is the knowledge system collective, is implicitly more accountable to these schools. Our mental map for how classrooms work, nah, is more accountable for Model C schools than perhaps what I call mainstream schools. Nah? So what's the difference about? And I think we know this, but I think sometimes it's useful to talk about that when we're collaborating. So Model C schools, the sociolinguistic context is very, very different. First of all, they're primarily English speaking. And what I mean by that is not that they're not African language speaking children, but first of all, there's incredible, what is they called, gates, what are those things called? Rules that prevent children from getting into these schools unless they've had good so-called ECD in English. So let's not be, nah? But even those kids that do get in, the two determining factors that make them very different is that teachers here are first language English speaking, and secondly, is English is a dominant language in the playground. Interestingly, out of all the factors, even in international literature, it's kids' dominant language on the playground that determines what's possible linguistically in the school. No? So what's different? By the way, in South Africa, as we know, there's all sorts of other things mixed in here, right? Histories of success. Teaching and learning works. Being a teacher transforms kids' lives. My children rise in the bones of the system. No? Parents that have some time and resources to invest in children's education. And as you know, there's actually a lot of resources that children invest there. Over here is very different. One, there's an African language in the playground, in the tea rooms, at home, in the communities. No? Secondly, it's terribly under-resourced. When I was, luckily, Samantha, by the way, we're good friends. So when I kind of went after her, I wasn't going after her in a mean way. But if you've ever seen these schools, doesn't matter what you think about language, you're not going to put your kid in there if you can get them into these schools. Let's be real. We have not invested a redress budget. No? And then the third thing that I wanted to talk about some today is there's just been a devastating kind of assault on meaning-making in math in that sector. And I think that goes back to apartheid in ways that we're only starting to historically dig up. I think historians need to be part of us to just understand how far it was collapsed. Oh, see, I'm on my first slide. That's what happens to me. I get on my first slide, I don't say anything more. So I was going to tell you some stories, but I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to tell you maybe one story. So this is the Ingrid Mostert story. I love Ingrid Sapire, but this is the Ingrid Mostert story. Some of you who know Ingrid Mostert will know that she was a colleague very close to me. She came into my life in around 2016. By the way, this is the theme of collaboration. See, I am on topic. And this woman walked in my room, and I was like very busy, and I thought, ish, this woman is going to tell me about all these things that work in Model C schools, and I'm not going to have much time, and I was like this. And she walked in, and I found a very different person than the people I'm used to working with. And if I go back to the previous slide, I'm not exactly sure to do that. She had basically decided to wrap herself around mainstream schools. And I think our own theory of change is that until we wrap ourselves as the people who are responsible for the Knowledge Project around mainstream schools and get very humbled by the fact that some of our ideas work and many of them don't, and replace those ideas with things that truly give a teacher a new gate, that we are going to continue smash the schools at the bottom of the system. Anyway, she had spent several years just sitting in mainstream school math classrooms and listening. She's called, I think of her as the teacher whisperer, She was an incredible listener, and she slowed down. She never for once had the idea that a teacher was somehow stupid if she was having different answers in math. And she was very, very interested in understanding their logic. I thought I was a patient person, but until I met her, I didn't know I wasn't a patient person. I wasn't listening properly. And she would often get it, she's like, slow down, and listen. And slowly but surely, I just want to talk to one of the design principles that emerges from that kind of work. You'll see up here, we asked teachers, and this was actually teachers who've been in a lot of training, how they would present the problem. This was probably 92 minus 58 to a grade 2 child. So this is not a child's work, this is a teacher's work. And it presents things again in ones. Now, for any of you know, this means that the kind of what's called reification or abstraction that we all absorb from living in a community where mathematics had sense has been unavailable to this teacher. She sees mathematics as a long series of ones. There's been no structuring by 10 of place value, no structuring by 5, no structuring by 2. What's particularly painful is if you count this up, what's amazing is it does add up to 92 minus 58, like unbelievable. So this is a committed teacher. But you'll see that the lines are not even structured by 10s. So we started thinking, because this comes up everywhere, well, it wouldn't be that painful if these lines were structured by 10. Because then you're starting to build a base 10 system. And then it would be even less painful if you would get teachers to circle the 10s, to reify the 10s. And then it would be even less painful if instead of drawing all the 1s, you could have them draw a 10. So through that, we've built Singapore has math, right? We're starting to build our South African math, a representation that was extremely easy for our teachers to leverage meaning making. And I know this probably sounds like, really? Are you really doing that? But we have teachers that they're ululating now because finally it makes sense. Because from there, you can get to sensible equations. So I just wanted to talk about, I'm not going to talk about the MCC. In some senses, the Magic Classroom Collective has been less about an intervention and more about going back and being listening, teacher whispers and listening and trying to understand what works in classrooms. It just went on its own. I don't know how to get, how do I get back? Oh, I guess I'm done. Am I done? Okay, let me just say that out of that, these design principles come out, and I think one of the ways we can collaborate is being much more transparent of our understanding of how classrooms operate and what design principles are appropriate to leverage some confidence in the system. Thanks very much.
Kim, for firstly outlining the principles of the bimodal distribution that we find ourselves in and how we can collaborate in order to lift teachers up and work in order to get better results. So I'm going to open it up to the floor, but I will say that we only have 5 minutes. So are there any takers from the floor? Any questions?
I think it is historical because when we started talking about young children, there was Froebelian people who were following Froebelian Montessoris and all that, and it will always be like that. Mm. And I think we need to elevate ourselves to that level of understanding that when we look at a child, we have our cultural lenses in it. When I do my research, it is influenced by who I am and how I was raised and how I see a child. So that I think we need to accept, and therefore in that manner it makes this space very rich. And there are diverse ways of solving a problem. There is something that I think when we talk about, because what I like, multidisciplinarity did come in what you were talking about. Because the issue of language, we cannot do it alone as people who are doing mathematics. I would like us to really bring the linguistic people, but I would also like us in South Africa to look at the neurologic aspect when we talk about young children. Because for us to be able to, our problems are complex. For us to be able to solve them, you can get your mic. We really need to be multidisciplinary now. We need neurology, we need linguistic, we need my friend there, language people, we need to come together and we really need to be genuine and authentic as we solve the language problem. It's complex.
Whenever we come to forums like this, it occurs to me how much more thinking is needed. You know, we implementers, but we're constantly trying to find something that works better. Mm. And there are lots of little things that have been working. So the first question is, how do we pick that up? I guess one of the first things is to assess well. Maybe that leads a bit well into the next session, but so we can know what actually is working and then start sharing that within the maths community, early grade maths community. So I guess there's a question of, can we make that happen? Because I think it would be very useful. And the second one is, how do we make the time to drill deeper? Because there's lots of areas here today that make me feel like we need to drill into a number of things as a group. And I don't really have an answer to that, but maybe you guys have some suggestions.
Thank you. I will now give the panel a chance to respond.
There are social-cultural lenses, social-political lenses, the theoretical lenses, empirical lenses, and it's not easy to just become one-dimensional about or technicist about what works and what doesn't work. But I think that there must be better ways in which we can agree on some guiding principles about what comprises quality, what comprises, you know, those kinds of things, so that we can all build on the work that we have and go forward. Because otherwise we operate in our little circles in small spaces and we justify it because we have theoretical differences or political differences or socio-political differences. These are difficult for me. I mean, a good example is, I think that Balawande and Kim and them had some engagement around the learner workbook, right? So there were some, I think, design principles, mathematical principles that were great in this book. They then took it, and there were adaptations. I think those things then are good things because we go forward. So I don't know how, but I think there must be ways in which we can recognize all these layers and levels, but certainly find ways to go forward. The problem I have is I don't know who decides, and I think that's the difficulty. Is it government? Are they the leaders? They drive? Are they the holders of this? Or is it a community? And how is that governed? And I think those are the difficulties.
Just to build on to what Fatima says, I mean, I think that there's easy discourse in this country that blames education on the DBE. And there's a whole the departmental problem. I think ultimately, obviously, the department will always have power to select what it thinks is reasonable and what it doesn't. But I don't think that as a community, and I would include funders and researchers and developers, we can say yet that we have been serving the department with enough substantive answers that allow us to think that they are choosing from the research that is designed to take the department forward. And I suppose the one thing, I mean, I know the next session we're going to do more assessment, but I would just try to build off of what Nosisi was saying. I would just try to say that in terms of who's choosing, I think we also need to be really careful. By the way, we do a lot of assessment in the MCC, and we've luckily had a lot of success. But I think we need to be really careful about saying the people, it's only to do with numbers. I'm a big assessment believer. But I think that we need to unleash the design principles in instruction and explain how those are operating in the classroom, rather than just say, this toolkit worked to increase things by 10%. Well, what? Right? Because they're not necessarily going to take your stuff or my stuff or somebody else's stuff. What is it that both the department can understand as well as other organizations can understand? What was the theory? And I don't mean grand theory. I mean the micro theory that you were playing with when you set things up like this. What pieces of it have been generative? What pieces of it perhaps haven't been a generative as one? And I think one of the only ways we're going to really do that is by building at least a cohort of successful African language dominant classrooms of teachers that have the confidence to talk back to us. And it's a hard thing to do. And I think, so some people wonder, why are you spending so much time in the MCC? You've worked with those schools. We think that there needs to be a cohorts of schools that are so confident that they can talk back to us as a collective sensibly about what works and where we're not seeing kind of the challenges of their classroom. So in the future, I think it's going to be lead teachers in mainstream schools that are going to have to really help us find the way through what works for the system.
All right, and thank you, panelists, again, for such a rich engagement.